Good evening, South Asians. It's great to have you back with us again on our monthly show of South Asian. Tonight, we have two very important people who are power behind power. Basically, we have two people who deal with energy from India and from Bangladesh. From India, we have Mr. R.V. Shahi, the longest-serving power secretary of India, ex, of course. And we have Dr. Kaikaus Ahmed, the current senior secretary for Bangladesh Ministry of Energy. Just a very quick general question, first to Mr. Shahi and then to Dr. Ahmed. So, Mr. Shahi, would you like to share any particular experience with us relating to your tenure as a Power Secretary of India for 5 years? Was there a moment that you were really proud of?
I think there are so many achievements that I can be proud of, but I would rank the transformation of electricity sector through the legislative measure, Electricity Act 2003. So Indian power sector was managed basically through two important legislations, very old legislation, Electricity Act 1910 and Electricity Supply Act 1948. Both these acts had outlived their utility in the changed context. Even after 60 years from independence, this was another challenge. That's why I'm mentioning to you that almost 60% of rural households did not have access to electricity. And according to 2001 census, and I came as power secretary in 2002, six states, which included Bihar, West Bengal, Orissa, Jharkhand, Assam, these states, 80 to 95% households did not have access, and UP, 80 to 95%. 60 is the overall average, not having access to electricity. These six states, 80 to 95%. And my own state, Bihar, 94% household did not have access to electricity. So therefore, you can see the effectiveness of these two legislations, how the sector was managed. So this was a big challenge for us to drive this electricity legislation through parliament. That was the NDA government of Mr. Bajpayee at that time. Mr. Bajpayee was determined that it should happen, that we should have this legislation. People had worked. I was also from outside, worked on this legislation draft and all. But there are many changes that were to be made. So this I would say at the top. Second, 91 to 2001, decade of lost opportunity. Private sector policy was very attractive. Government guarantees for investment. Power purchase agreement by states. But since sector was bankrupt at the distribution end of the business, many of the problems even today exist. Investment did not come. We could not get more than 5,000 to 6,000 megawatt of capacity. So therefore, deficit used to be in the range of 20%, some of the states 25% peak deficit. So this was, so you do a legislation and that legislation is not enough. We used to say, act is necessary, but it is not sufficient. That means we used to say, do the act, but more importantly, take actions. So following this act, we had national electricity policy, national tariff policy, rural electrification policy, whole range of issues. And I would feel that this did enthuse investors, did enthuse bankers. 2002, the situation was that bankers had abandoned this sector because of their fear that they will be in trouble because the sector was such. So I think saying that what I could rank as the important achievement during that period, and these have yielded huge benefits. Today we have 350,000 megawatt capacity. Then we had 120,000 megawatt capacity, 350. It includes renewables of almost 75,000 megawatts. So I think today we can claim that we have, many of our people have started saying that, do we have surplus? I don't believe that, because with this capacity also, our per capita consumption of electricity is just 1,100. Now, we need not compare with Western countries, but Can't we compare with China and others where you have three times of this, more than three times? So obviously we have a long way to go, but cutting it short, this would be the best of the achievement that we have been able to get.
Dr. Kaikal Samad, so what was your most glorious moment in these last couple of years?
Well, obviously the first one is being the power secretary. I think in my case, I'm enjoying the benefit of my predecessors. When you see something, it doesn't happen right away. Let me go back a bit. I mean, since Mr. Shahi was mentioning, Bangladesh started its journey, obviously, in 1971, December 16. Do you know, right after that, in 1972, the father of the nation created Power Development Board. Before that, it was one with Water Development and Power Development, which was called actually WAPDA. So he realized it. And the second significant change was in 1996, creating private power generation policy. Then, I think at the same time with India, the unbundling has started in 2003, actually, our Bangladesh Energy Regulatory Commission Act was enacted. However, then the significant another policy change was in 2010, creating this opportunity for speedy purchase. So what happened is that, this journey started with a vision, and which is now where I am, and our predecessors has also, the government has enacted some laws to create the environment, to create the opportunities for the private sector as well as the public sector. And then, I think we are where we are now. And everybody remembered, I believe, 2006-07 when the economy was shooting up and we did not realize that we need power. So there was a big gap. And this gap, I don't think would have been shortened, or the gap was addressed without this kind of extra initiative. So through this process, now my glorious moment, if I say, is that I am in a situation now with a huge interest from international companies, private sector in Bangladesh, private sector outside the Bangladesh, regional companies, everybody is interested in Bangladesh. Now I have a strong seat on which I can say yes or no. I mean, in a sense that I am basically sorting out which one is the best. So I think this is a very strong moment for me to enjoy, but at the same time, I have to admit that that was created by my predecessors so that I can now have the, situation to look after, to analyze, and at the same time
to
prioritize, which one I'm going to take. Bangladesh, especially in power sector, I don't feel that we have any shortage of investment, any shortage of interest, any shortage of international focus. Why? Because we have been able to prove that the power sector of Bangladesh is a good paymaster. We have a very strong legal environment through which investors feel 100% secured to invest in Bangladesh. And just to mention one other thing, in Bangladesh, I think the power sector has created a very strong private sector. Let me give you an example. In 2017, we realized that there is a gap in supply and demand. So the government has decided to identify power private, players in the private sector which have done good before, and then call them and to give them LOI, which is letter of intent, to implement the project within 9 months. So we did it. First of all, let me also glorify myself, is that when we got the approval from the Honorable Prime Minister, we concluded it in 25 days. And we told them that this is the alloy, go to the market, you have to start, your clock is started to click. You know, alloy globally cannot be considered as the, you know, starting point. But our...
You did.
Our private sector accepted it.
Yes.
And then they went to the banks, and banks basically provided them funding. And almost all of them, you know, there was 2-3 months delays, which is quite normal in this kind of huge investment. But everybody...
But you also penalized the...
Yes. Well, there is penalized. But the thing is that they have successfully completed it, 2,300 megawatts, which is around $2.3 billion of work. That is what we have been able to basically energize in this power sector. And that is where we stand. And then, you know, we are looking forward to move. Actually, this is not the end. I think this is the beginning.
Wonderful. So while Dr. Ahmed speaks about his choices now, he has multiple choices to choose from. He has companies coming in, wanting to invest in local energy scenario. Do you think that actually creates difficulties for local power producers? Do you see any? Because you're one person, Mr. Shahi, who has basically invested a lot of time and energy in cross-border energy. And because Indians are coming in now, mostly, it also adds a little bit of fear in the minds of the local power producers. Do you think the fear is valid at all?
No, I think I have been part and parcel of this process. I may tell you that when the new government came in 2009, and that's the time I had just a couple of years back, I had retired from the government, and I was approached by the World Bank whether I could advise Bangladesh. I said, I cannot be advisor to the Bangladesh government, but I could be advisor to World Bank and advise Bangladesh that way. We were quite concerned that if we pick up large projects which the local investors would not be able to cope with, would it create a problem? And therefore, if you see the process that went through last 10 years, you have large projects and we have also small projects, small, medium, projects in the range of 100 megawatt, projects in the range of 300 megawatt, and many of those projects are by local people. I would say that this was a part of the deliberate discussion and a strategy. We were, what you were saying, one was conscious of that. This government here was conscious of that. Now we are trying to do the same thing in transmission. Rural electrification, you see. Rural electrification, huge investments. Rural electrification is the most successful example in Bangladesh. Because I often tell our friends in other countries in South Asia that this is the best managed rural electrification and rural electricity supply among all the countries. See, this is the investors' desire, that there should be no competition. The government of the day has to serve the larger interest of consumers. So we have seen when competition is created, multiple players are there. But of course, there is a danger. Too many multiple players and too much of competition also, if kills the industry, we need to have a balance. So I would feel that the policy deliberately articulated here, architectured here, does address that concern. And in coming days, rural electrification, and we are now working on transmission systems also to be given to private sector. And the transmission systems will be different segments. It may be 100 kilometer, it could be 200 kilometer, it could be 50 kilometer.
Very capital intensive.
And then you will have huge opportunities for the local investors.
Thank you, Mr. Shahi. Dr. Ahmed, on that note, I'd like to pose my next question to Mr. Shahi. But before that, let's go for a break. And we're back from the break, and I'd now like to shift to Dr. Ahmed and ask him about the local scene, about this thriving, competitive opportunities coming up, and whether, as Mr. Shahi had suggested, that maybe transmission is going to be the new business.
Obviously, first of all, we have been able to increase our number in generation, but it has to be transmitted. So transmission is a big issue, and most often you will find that in rural areas we are having interruption. So it's because not shortage of electricity production, but it's basically the transmission. So since there is a shortage of transmission facilities, obviously there is opportunity. And coming back to this, fear. I don't think that, first of all, I interact with the business community in Bangladesh, and I don't think that anybody is afraid of facing competitors. I can speak on behalf of our entrepreneurs. And as
can you know, speak for the activists as well?
Oh, activists are different. However, if you want me to talk about a little bit of activists, I think this is something gray areas. We are talking on activism without numbers. Let me give you one of the concerns about the sustainability as well as so-called climate change. Not so-called, it's real. However, what is the role of Bangladesh and what is the role of our sector? That has to be analyzed.
So power sector versus sustainability?
Yes.
Or is it the same?
Not at all. I think there is, I can prove you with numbers that our role is insignificant. First of all, Mr. Shahi is sitting just beside me. So he is India, I am Bangladesh. He is the fourth largest polluter in the world. I am not. My per capita carbon emission is 0.4. But he's most. But the worst part is that even if I pollute the environment from Bangladesh or India, the impact is same. So if I make myself 100% clean, if India does not, that means, the impact remains the same. So what to do?
So we might as well pollute.
No. What we are doing is basically we are increasing our cooperation. We are trying to identify regionally where we can increase the renewable energy. That is how we are addressing it. That is how we are trying to mitigate the climate change. And this is the process that, during his watch has started. And we are intensifying the, activities. For example, India has a very high potential and still they're doing it. Great job in solar power. So if we, on the other hand, solar power in Bangladesh is becoming costly because of land issues and other solar radiation. So instead of focusing me in solar production in Bangladesh, I can extend my hand towards India, and then I can increase my pie. So that means regionally, and India has a very high potential in hydro, Bhutan has hydro, yeah. Nepal has hydro, even Myanmar has an hydro.
So BBIN is probably the thing to follow right now, because Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, I think this story is probably a better success story than the entire region of SAARC at this point of time, because I think historical changes are taking place. Would you want to share with the audience?
We must thank the World Bank for institutionalizing this process, that we have set up at two levels, the champions, and on the energy sector at power secretaries. Power secretaries roundtable and champions, and champions would be not only for power but for most other areas where bilateral, trilateral, BBIN, sub-regional, regional collaboration should happen. In fact, energy is the most important issue, important subject, which explains how this cooperation can address solidly the concerns about climate change. In South Asia, or in BBIN area, you can say, more than 300,000 megawatt of potential of hydro is there, more than 300,000. India has harnessed about 45,000, overall it is only 50,000 megawatt. Nepal has more than 100,000 megawatt, it has done hardly 1,500 megawatt. Sustainability also means that mitigatory measures have to be put in place. If we deprive people from access to electricity, then the consequence is worse than trying to make it sustainable otherwise. So you had a choice. Now today, this sub-regional and regional collaboration which we are facilitating through the champion process and secretary's roundtable, etc., is leading to very good conclusions. Only recently, Government of India has decided and has formulated a cross-border electricity trade guidelines, and it allows going beyond bilateral. Bangladesh can buy power from Nepal, can buy power from Bhutan, from the hydro. India would agree, has agreed in this guideline to allow it to move through India. Commercial arrangement will be put in place. It could be Nepal power is going to Sri Lanka, where transmission connectivity is established and is proposed to be established. So we are trying to create infrastructure of transmission in a manner that power trade among the South Asian countries, but more importantly among the BBIN area particularly, they become quite extensive. Therefore, using the natural resources which are available in different countries in an optimized manner, not only you can have power at lesser cost, but you can also address the issue of what you said, sustainability from the point of view of environment, sustainability. Sustainability will have different meanings, but from the point of view of environment, climate change, I think energy collaboration will go a long way.
So collaboration in place of competition.
Yes.
Is that the way to go?
Competition and collaboration together.
Competition is always there.
Yeah, competition
is there. But collaboration is also going to intensify the process.
What about joint ventures? Will Bangladeshis and Indians or Bangladeshis and Bhutanese, will they also be allowed to joint investments?
No. You know that a big power project is coming in Bangladesh, which is their biggest organization, BPDV, and India's biggest power organization, NTPC. That was also one of the things.
Private sector collaboration.
Private sector collaboration is always possible.
There's always possible.
Yeah,
there's always possibility. My last question to you. So you see basically no danger in cross-border exchange whatsoever, and you're welcoming it. How are you, you know, our historical mindsets against collaboration runs deep in the subcontinent as well. How are you battling this? I mean, how are you facing up to all the critique about coal, about renewables, and about, of course, being pretty closely knit to your neighbors, because there is an inherent distrust. How are you handling the PR front of it?
You see, all these fears go away when leadership is very strong. And we have seen this in case of India and Bangladesh. Moreover, let me give you an example of, Europe. You know, for a couple of centuries, they fought with each other. Now, they don't fear each other. Why? Because economic ties are very strong now. And especially like in case of electricity, they are also connected to each other. So I think this mistrust or fear will decrease as we intensify the, you know, economic ties, and in every sense. That will basically bring peace in this area, in my opinion. And I am a student of economics. I believe free trade, free, you know, interactions will always bring peace.
The mistrust was because of the fact that we were talking, things were not happening. So some people became skeptical about the whole thing. Even when we started this 500 megawatt HVDC and transfer of power, in your press here, until really it happened, people didn't believe it will happen. Because many things on these matters, they go on and on for years. Similar thing was tempting to be happening in case of Bhutan power coming to Bangladesh, joint venture. But those things are becoming real. So I think a few success stories, and it is there where consideration by the governments, particularly from Indian side, and that is how I have been trying to convince there, and I'm happy that sort of take is there, that we need not always be talking of trade-off, that quid pro quo, a little bit of consideration, and make a few success stories, then it generates more and more confidence. When it happened in case of India and Bangladesh, this 500 megawatt HVDC, the then High Commissioner of Bangladesh in India, Mr. Tariq Karim, mentioned to me that he was attending a conference with High Commissioner of Pakistan in India. And when somebody was saying this has happened, he asked him, has it happened really? So therefore, fear and skepticism, that has generated mistrust and distrust. I think On energy side, on power side particularly, I think that is not there. That is the type of feedback you get. The same is the, then we have put institutional mechanism in place so that if there are concerns, there are doubts, even today there were some doubts about HVDC and otherwise, we try to dispel those doubts and come to some consensus. That's
so
the way
examples
it
have been set. The success stories need to be told with a lot of pride and
yes,
integrity.
Exactly.
And we certainly look forward to a glorious regional collaboration.
Yes.
Amongst all the South Asian countries that we have. Thank you, Mr. Shahi, for being
much.
With
Thanks
us. Thank
lot.
You, Dr.
Thank
Ahmed.
You.
It was a pleasure having
Thanks
you
Thanks a lot.
So Nepal and Bhutan have huge hydro potential. Bangladesh has a challenge of cross-border transmission, has an opportunity of transmission business, and of course, India's right there. With all this flexibility and intermanageability, South Asia moves on. Whether it's power, whether it's any other sector, we still need to be together and we need to have one voice. Thank you for watching South Asian, and we'll be back again next month. Same time, same place.
নতুন নতুন ভিডিও পেতে নাগরিকের ইউটিউব চ্যানেলটি সাবস্ক্রাইব করুন এবং পাশে থাকা বেল আইকনটি চাপুন।